Good evening. Thank you so much for coming tonight. My name is Lynn Goldman, and I'm Director of Marketing here. And as you know, we started this author series. This is the last one for 2012. And I'm so happy to see the nice turnout. Please continue to tell people about it, because that's the way it's going to continue. If people here see that we have a nice turnout, we're going to be able to continue the program. For 2013, we're working on some incredible people, just the way we have them for 2012. This series has gotten so much publicity recently. I don't know if I mentioned to a couple of you that a publisher in New York called me and said to me, "I think what you're doing in the northwest corner is amazing. And can you tell me how you're getting people to come up here?" So I feel really good about it. From a major publishing company, and this just happened. So, yes, thank you. I heard Lucinda Franks a couple years ago speak in Litchfield, and it was riveting. I loved her story. I loved her presentation. So when I knew I had to put together a program for this year, I wanted her on the schedule. And she's really incredible. She's a former staff writer for the New York Times. She's written regularly for the New Yorker, the New York Times Magazine, the Atlantic, and other publications. She was the first woman to win the Pulitzer Prize for national reporting, and she's won many other awards. She lives in New York City with her husband, former longtime district attorney for New York County, Robert M. Morgenthau. In her moving memoir, My Father's Secret War, Lucinda Franks discovers that her father had been a daring spy behind enemy lines in World War II. He began to reveal details of his wartime activities only in the last years of his life. It is at this time that Ms. Franks finally got to know her father. It is with great pleasure that I present Lucinda Franks.
Thank you so much, Lynn. It's a great pleasure to be here, particularly since it took me about 5.5 hours to get here. I don't live 5.5 hours away. I only live, I don't know how long it is, but I live in New York City, and one thing and another, I got lost. I have no sense of direction, and ended up, you know, I think in another state, but anyways, I'm very happy to be here. I'm so happy that all of you are here. I consider your generation I consider your generation to have given so much to our generation that I think you're all American heroes. And I'd like to begin by telling you about my relationship with my dad when I was a little girl. He was tall, handsome, completely full of surprises. We would go butterfly hunting one day. We would look through a big white telescope at the stars. The next, when I was 5 years old, because he was a very good marksman, he taught me how to shoot a pistol. And he lined up dull pineapple cans on the porch rail and aimed, he said, "Just shoot." So I said, "I can't." He said, "Yes, you can." And I said, "Daddy, I don't want to shoot Mom. She's right there." And he hadn't seen her because she was kind of around the door a little. And she scurried back in. And I hit 3 of the 7 pineapple cans and gathered his great admiration. And oh, that moment that I did that, and he just was so proud of me. It was great. So we had this wonderful relationship. And then when I became about 13 years old, I started asking him, mostly because of school projects, what he had done in the war. And every time I asked him, he would say, "Ah, I roasted a pet pig, and we all shared it because we didn't have anything but K rations." He would tell me funny stories, but he would never tell me whether he was in battle or whether he really took part in the war. Finally, he walked away from me after the last question I asked him. He became remote. He absented himself from my life, as he had with all adults. He was a very, they called him an odd bird where I grew up in Wellesley, Massachusetts, because he was so remote and everyone wanted to get to know him because he was so mysterious, but he wouldn't open up. When I was 25, my mother died, and my sister and I packed up three generations of memorabilia from our house, moved the cartons and him into an apartment, and he was very happy there, and we asked him if he wanted help in unpacking those cartons, and he said, "Nope, I'm doing it myself," and he claimed he had done it himself. However, he never allowed me to come to visit him at his house, at his apartment. He always would come to see us, to see his grandchildren, to see me, although our relationship really was not the same as we had when I was a little girl. It was very strained. We even had trouble talking about the weather. One day, and I really felt like I didn't have a father. You know, he just wasn't there. I received a special delivery letter one day from his landlord, who said he was going to be evicted from his apartment because it was a fire hazard, so full of paraphernalia that, you know, it could go up in smoke at any point. And so I grabbed my 6-year-old daughter, Amy, and we made our way to Milford, Massachusetts from New York City. And my father was standing in the doorway of his apartment in his gentlemanly way, saying, "Why, how nice to see you. Come right in." And inside his house were teetering towers of cartons. He had not unpacked one of the cartons that we had packed up. I was really flabbergasted. And he gave me a big hug, but he saved the biggest hug for his granddaughter. And I'd like to read you a passage from what I found in that house, in that apartment. "My father loves his quirky granddaughter with her Alice in Wonderland hair and heart-shaped lips. This unsmiling man comes alive in her presence. Sometimes he'll make his hands into bird's wings and flap them at her, or put his thumbs in his ears and wave. She rewards him by breaking out into giggles. Sometimes he'll just look at her and say, 'My little princess.' I was his little princess once upon a time. Just he and I and a huge white telescope in the middle of the dew-soaked lawn. He bought it for me when I was 5. Spring, summer, fall, winter, we would go out stargazing, peering cheek to cheek through the large lens he had ground himself, like twin stars huddling in the northern crown. January is our favorite month. Although the cold sometimes brings on my asthma, that's when my favorite constellation is high in the sky. He lifts me up, I shiver under 2 blankets, my eyes widening at the wonder of the galaxy. 'Look, Cindy, look to the left. Do you see the 3 bright stars? What are they?' 'Orion's belt, Daddy.' the mighty warrior slowly emerges as Daddy points out each star, giving life to the head, the bright knee, the red cloud of gas that is his tummy. Orion, sword drawn back, so tall he can wade through the deepest sea. Sometimes the star, shimmering like the sequins on Mother's silk gown, makes me short of breath. I try to muffle my wheezes, but Daddy always knows. He hears the cats meowing in my chest and carries me away, leaving our beloved galaxy for a bed clammy with steam. As I grow older, we hurtle out of the orbit that held us together. He's away from home more and more on mysterious business trips. The telescope slowly rusts in the garage. He acts with me as he acts with all adults, emotionally impenetrable, a voyager to places I cannot reach. I become caught in a conundrum. My father acts as though he loves me, but if this is so, why is he so far away? Like someone whose real self has been sucked up forever into the jaws of a big black hole. Now, 30 years later, I find myself unpacking cartons in the house in his apartment. Stained and crumbling to the touch, the cartons reveal old brocade napkins and lace doilies, satin nightgowns that my mother loved so much. She bought them in different shades of pastel. They're limp, musty. I lift out diamond-shaped bottles, faintly redolent of her favorite Shalimar perfume. Long white slips, bras with hooks crawling like centipedes down the back. Girdles yellowed with age, the rubber brittle and cracking. Under some of the items of my mother's that I am throwing away, mostly Red Cross files, she was the president of the Red Cross, I find two small boxes. One is a flat cardboard box sealed securely with layers of a kind of duct tape. I use a sharp knife to open it and find one empty army green film can and 10 transparent envelopes with tiny rolls of negatives inside. I hold them up to the light. They're snapshots of distant ships, some aircraft, blurred factory-type buildings with smokestacks, also a series of what looks like some kind of machine and boiler. Boring pictures. Why were they taken? Next, I find a wooden cigar box whose latch is rusted out. Inside are what appear to be old navy pins and tiny bars of different colored ribbon. There's a smattering of foreign money, blue notes from New Caledonia, two large silver coins from Britain, French francs, a few Swedish kroner, and then a crease square of thin brown paper. It looks like the toilet paper we used when I was based in London for UPI. The paper has three names on it: Bourbon, Granny, Alf. I also find a receipt from a restaurant, or maybe it's a bar in Gothenburg, Sweden. I can't make out the name or date. And a carefully folded square of silky material. I open it to find a map written in fine black ink with the destination X in a circle. The street names are smeared, unreadable. What on earth do all these things mean? I fish down to the bottom of the carton, and suddenly I'm holding a military cap. It's grayish green with white trim and a sharp peak rising high above the brim and then sloping down the back. At the top is the raised metal insignia of an eagle, and at the bottom, a skull and crossbones. Now I find a threaded badge in the shape of a cross with flared sides and a thin white border. Was it what my mother had sewn on her Red Cross jacket during the war when she drove trucks full of wounded soldiers? But no, it seems too big. I turn the badge over and I feel a chill. There's a swastika inside the middle of the cross, a symbol of the Nazi party. I examine the cap again, and sure enough, in a circle just below the eagle is another raised swastika, an iron cross, a Nazi cap in my father's house. After those discoveries, I was set on an 8-year search to find out who my father was. And what I found was that you can think that one person, that someone you love is one kind of person one day, and find out they are completely different than you thought. I thought at first my mother had an affair with a Nazi, because these things were found in her belongings. Then I thought maybe my father, the whole mystery of my father, was that he had been a Nazi spy. I went to him, asked him what these things were. He refused to talk about it. I began to try to tease information out of him, but at 82 years of age, Dad was very stubborn, very smart, and said he had taken an oath of silence. Of course, this to me was a giveaway that he had done secret undercover work. So I proceeded to read every World War intelligence book, OSS history, memoirs, monographs of agents. The only thing my dad would tell me was that he had become a first lieutenant in the Navy and was assigned to the Bureau of Ordnance Weapons Department in a special unit that operated under an admiral who was known to be very flamboyant and friends with Donovan, who was the head of the OSS, the wartime, of course, you know, the wartime spy agency. Now, I knew that my dad was a crack marksman, a pistol shooting champion until he was in his 80s, a man with a photographic memory and a deadpan demeanor, and an amazing facility for learning languages and just about any other discipline within a short time. Moreover, as a chemical engineer, he had taught himself German because the best books on chemistry were written by German scientists. He also had spent summers in Germany studying the subject and learning the habits and the slang of the German people. My husband, who is New York DA Robert Morgenthau, former, and a World War II veteran himself, concluded that my father would have been snapped up right away for undercover work. I began questioning him now using every reporter's trick I could find. He loved my apple brown Betty, the only thing in the world I could cook. So I made him, you know, a big dish. He wasn't allowed to smoke in my house. I put an ashtray in front of him, and I said, "Dad, go ahead, you know, have some fun." And when he finished his apple brown Betty and was smoking his pipe, I would ask him leading questions. Like, I remember one time, I had just finished a book on spy weapons made by the OSS, and one of these weapons was called a stinger. It was a little gun that was supposed to kill somebody at close range, but it couldn't even do that. It was a real stinker. So I said, "Daddy, what's a stinger?" And he said, "Well, that's a drink that will turn you green. I don't advise you drinking it." And I said, "No, Dad, not that kind of stinger. I mean the kind of stinger that could wipe out, was made by the OSS, and could wipe out a whole battalion of German soldiers." And he took down his glasses and he said, "Where did you get that from? Well, that was the worst weapon we ever made." So now I knew he was in the OSS. and had made secret spy weapons. That discovery was a turning point, because I can't tell you how excited I was to imagine that my bland monosyllabic father might be hiding another man who was much more romantic, much more substantial. I began to remember things about my childhood, like a game he played with me, which was called Writing Small. We'd start with, say, a word like cat, and we'd take turns writing it smaller and smaller and smaller, until, of course, my father would win, because he'd write it so small, it was like a period. So, you know, you couldn't read it. And often he'd let me win, but I often wondered why he invented this game, and I found out through reading some of these World War II intelligence books that couriers for the French resistance had messages written very, very small writing on rice paper. So if they were about to be caught by Nazis, they could pop it in their mouth and swallow it. I wrote away for his military records, which came back incomplete. I wrote the CIA and the FBI, and I scoured the National Archives, and I turned up nothing. Not even his name wasn't anywhere. This journey was becoming excruciating. I felt like I was blown back and forth in the wind. One week I would come back from the National Archives dejected, sure this was all an illusion, and I would quit the project. Then, a few months later, I get a call back from an old war buddy of his who finally decided to return my call and would tell me some nuggets, such as the fact that he had been in a hush-hush radar unit called Argus that spotted Japanese planes and directed fighters to shoot them down. That was a kind of a radar the Japanese didn't know that we had. So off I went, back to the Navy Yard in Washington, but I couldn't find anyone, no official, no archivist, who had ever heard of this Argus unit. I began to get suspicious, particularly when the CIA and the FBI never answered my stream of letters, including letters from my senator and my congressman. I found later that the archives were sanitized of any juicy undercover, really big undercover work. They say they've declassified all World War II materials, but that is just not so. So I got excited again. I thought, well, maybe my father got oral orders, or got orders that he had to tear up. And so maybe he really was doing undercover work. I wanted greatly for this to be true, because it would mean that I would regain the father I lost. You see, when he came back from the war, so changed. He'd failed in his marriage. He'd inevitably failed as an executive in a steel company, failed as a father. The thought that he had been somebody, perhaps even a hero, was exhilarating. I finally got a very big break in my quest. My father read somewhere that all oaths of silence were now nullified, it being 50 years after the war. So he began to talk to me, and the memories just tumbled out. What I found out that he had done shocked, even frightened me. He had posed as a Nazi in the French resistance, assassinating Nazi officers, even people that were questionable from our own side. But the event that made the most impact on him was his liberation of the first Allied, the first concentration camp found by the Allies called Ohrdruf. He was ordered to examine every corner of the camp and to present a handwritten intelligence report to his superiors. He was told never to talk about it or even remember it. What he saw changed him forever, changed his personality. He was stunned and disoriented, and he left the camp and was told never to tell anybody. He repressed the visit for decades until one fateful day, just before I began in earnest my search for what my father had done. It happened in a bar with a group of friends. He was waiting for a table for dinner, and the fellow next to him, he was about 75 at the time, fellow next to him, about in, you know, late 20s, was making virulent anti-Semitic remarks, you know, kite, that kind of thing. And my father's best friend, Lou, saw his hand tighten around his glass, and Lou looked away, and he looked back, and my father wasn't there. He had just kind of leaped over, pushed this young fellow down, held him down with his arms, and pushed his thumb into his carotid artery. He was trying to kill him. It took five men to get him off, this young fellow. He had never done any, never raised his voice or his hand to anybody before. So his friend Lou took him home and said, "Tom, what happened there?" And my father broke down for the first time, and he told his memory of the camps had come flooding back when he heard those anti-Semitic remarks. And he remembered how the army and the brass were so disbelieving and guilty when they found the camps that their initial desire was to tell everybody, to keep it a secret. I just want to read you a short passage about not what my father found, but how he felt, or how I thought he felt when he found it. "I wanted to see what Dad saw in Ordruf. I wanted to walk with that skinny lieutenant with the crew cut and the smooth baby skin, follow him into that apocalyptic place. I wanted to watch him put pencil to paper and document the scene as he'd been told to do, as though it were a routine, as routine as taking an inventory of warehouses filled with ordnance, counting stacks of rifles and guns and grenades. I went down to the library at the Museum of Jewish Heritage in New York. An hour later, I was sitting in a cubicle filled with old newspaper articles and the written and audio and videotape testimony on Ordruf given by other soldiers. Ordruf. Bach composed some of his most sacred works there. The name sounded strange to me, like an imaginary land of moats and milkweed. It was a satellite, in fact, of the Buchenwald death camp, originally established in 1944 to provide labor in the surrounding hills. The prisoners dug tunnels for gun emplacements and laid railroad tracks there that would carry Hitler and his aides into an underground headquarters if the Allies got too close. The retreat was to be the Führer's birthday present, but he killed himself in his Berlin bunker before it could be given to him. When he received early eyewitness reports from the soldiers, Eisenhower, the supreme commander of the Allied forces in Europe, said he was too busy to visit the camp. The Allies were closing in Germany. The American High Command was chasing Jewish gold and artworks worth millions of dollars that had been seized by the Nazis. They were too busy. Lieutenant Colonel Louis Weinstein, a chief aide of Ike, urged him to go to Ordruf. Ike responded by telling the Jewish officer, I know it's especially important to you personally, but I just can't. Weinstein replied, it's not that it's important to me, General. The issue is that the world must know about the atrocities. The world wouldn't believe them if they come secondhand. But if General Eisenhower and others like him are there on the scene and can relate exactly what happened, that will make a great deal of difference. When I continued to stonewall him, Weinstein pleaded with him a second time. Weinstein, the general said in dismay, I told you I'm busy. There's the door, now get. Finally, 8 days later, on April 12th, 1945, Eisenhower visited Ordruff. General Omar Bradley and General George Patton accompanied him. The scenes of devastation were undisturbed. The bodies that had been shot still lay exactly where they'd been found. Eisenhower's face whitened into a mask, according to General Bradley, as he deliberately inspected every corner of the camp. The gallows, the whipping block, the block used to smash the gold out of the mouths of prisoners. He wanted to be able to say that he'd personally investigated every inch so he could counter, quote, the belief or assumption that the stories of Nazi brutality were just propaganda. I can state equivocally, he said, that all written statements up to now do not paint the full horrors. And this was somebody who was too busy to go to see it for a couple of weeks. I was told that my father's report of Ordruff was one of the reports that convinced Eisenhower to go to Ordruff. This whole process of my slowly getting his secrets out of him was painful for my father, but that paled before the lightness he felt when he finally had gotten rid of all that anger and guilt, the sadness of his World War II experiences. They were ghosts that had haunted him all his life. I realized that like so many other World War II soldiers, he had been suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome. Back in the 40s, there was no such condition. They called it
shell shock
or battle fatigue, combat fatigue. And the veterans were encouraged not to talk about what happened to them to their wives or loved ones when they got home. And they just wanted to get on with their lives anyways. The fact that my father had PTSD was crystal clear to me when I found another hidden cache in his closet. Letters that he'd written to my mother at the start of his duty when he was stationed in the Pacific. The letters were so joyful, so full of life and ambition, I had to keep looking at the return address to make sure they were really written by my dad. He played pranks on the other men. He had a pet iguana, Oscar, that he carried around everywhere. And he talked of the beauty of the islands in a way I had never heard him talk before. Most baffling were the pages and pages of endearments that he wrote to my mother. I love you, I love you, I love you, over and over again. I had never heard my father say I love you to anyone, least of all to my mother. Their marriage was one of strain and fights and very little affection. So in 3 short years of the war, my father had changed completely from a hopeful, lively human being who looked forward to the future to a man who was depressed and tortured by the past. During my search, Dad and I had a reconciliation. We laughed. We listened to his favorite ragtime player, Knuckles O'Toole. We sat beside the buddleia bushes and watched for butterflies. One day, a few weeks before he passed away, he looked at me, and out of the blue, he said the words he hadn't said before and that I'd always longed to hear. Cindy, Did I ever tell you I love you so much? My sister and I wanted not to make a big fuss out of my father's funeral. We thought he would rather just be cremated and no ceremony. But my husband, who'd been through the war and who knew my father intimately, said, "Not on your life." And he picked up the phone and he said, "We're gonna give him a big send-off." So he ended up having a funeral on the Intrepid, the destroyer Intrepid, docked in New York, the museum now. And he had a 10-gun salute, full military honors, folding of the flag that was given to me, and we watched a wreath being thrown overboard and floating on towards the horizon. My father finally received the recognition he had been denied in his life. Thanks. I never tire of talking about this, because, you know, it was just life-changing for me. But I'd love to hear any questions or any stories anybody has would like to tell. And I know it's hard to be the first one, but there has to be a first one. Yes.
Okay. I happened to just hear on the radio today an author whose name I didn't catch, I tuned in late, talking about veterans of World War II and how, like, your father never spoke, never talked about it. And he said he asked several, he interviewed several for this particular book. And one of these soldiers said, if you had spent 555 days of car crashes, because that's how horrible it all was, would you want to talk about it?
Right. Yeah. Right.
Wouldn't you want to just not even think about
that's,
it?
That's an oath of silence or not. Mm-hmm. I think that was the root of why the veterans didn't talk. And now, of course, they're talking. I mean, I've gotten 200, 300 letters from both veterans who want to talk and who don't know how to approach their loved ones and to tell them the horrible things that they saw or did. I've gotten letters from children who want to know from their parents but don't want, you know, to invade their father's privacy. How do they do it? I think there's a big movement now to, you know, expose and to talk about what they never talked about before. And the children are just dying to hear everybody's stories.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Was your father serving in the OSS during part of the war?
Yes, it was a little complicated.
Was he back and forth between the OSS and the Army? Because when he went into the concentration camp,
he was with the Army. He was with the Third Army, right?
Yeah.
Well, actually, he was in a unit, a special spy unit that preceded the Third Army. He was called a roving troubleshooting spy, and he was in naval intelligence. Then he was attached to the OSS by this Admiral Blandy, who was friends of Donovan. And then he was attached from the OSS to Army Intelligence when he, you know, was sent ahead to scout out, you know, what this concentration camp was. So he was a little bit of everywhere and did a little bit of everything. From the French Resistance to the Italian Protestants.
So how did you learn or verify these historical details? Did the Army or the archives, relevant archives, freely let you see things that your father was identified?
No. It was all circumstantial evidence. Well, it was firsthand testimony from the few war buddies which I could contact, who at first told me he wasn't a spy. They had been under an oath of silence, and then told me he was, sometimes after the book had been published. Mm-hmm. That was really useful. The archives would have a letter from Donovan in kind of half code language to a letter to Blandy, which is my father's, who was my father's admiral in the Bureau of Ordnance, asking for my father on a certain mission. So I had to put it together from all these different things, and then, you know, get it confirmed again, and, you know, by my father and by, you know, any records I could get my hands on.
Where did you find a letter like the one you mentioned from Donovan to Blandy?
On the microfiche in the National, on a special rung of the National Archives.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Every time I didn't want to write, every time I couldn't stand, I would go to the National Archives.
Yeah.
We spent hours and hours there. Yes, sir.
I'm sorry I came a little bit late and maybe discussed this already, but given the various fields your father worked in during the war, you briefly described who he was, his personality, his education, and demeanor that suited him for this kind of work. It was actually very special. And
yeah. Right. It's actually interesting. I mean, I'll tell you, you know, just tick off the ways, then I'll tell you the story. He had a deadpan demeanor. He spoke fluent German. He was a crack marksman. He could pick up any language in a week. He could pick up any piece of knowledge and know it as though he was. I mean, he could be a poker player, a professional poker player, within a week, or a cross-country bicyclist. He could absorb knowledge that way to photographic memory. But my husband, they had you fill out a form that both my husband and my father, who were in at a little different times. My husband is younger than my father and is still alive. The form said, pull out of questions, and then it said, would you serve in an underground capacity? My husband said yes with a exclamation point. My father said no in big bold letters. Do you speak any languages? My husband said Latin. My father said German, French, Japanese, on and on. And of course, my father was picked, not only because of his particular skills, but because they needed people to speak languages to go in and pose as one of the citizens, one of the innocent citizens, rather than a spy.
What was his age?
Did
you?
My father's age when?
When he went into.
He was older. He was about 28. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Did you have to get any permission to write this book or to have it submitted to any organization in Washington or any department?
No, I wanted information from them, and they didn't give me any information, so I hardly thought that I should give them my book. However, I was sitting at a Just 6 months ago, I was sitting next to, at a luncheon, the station chief of the CIA for New York. And he said, you know, we all read your book. And I said, oh, what book was that? And he said, My Father's Secret War, about your father. And I said, oh, really? And he said, yes, it was chocolate. And we thought about doing something about it. And I said, well, what would you have done? Killed me? And he said, no, we might have prevented you from letting out some of that stuff. And
I said, also concerned with freedom of the press.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And also, they never answered my letters. Yeah, so, if, you know, if somebody had been on the ball, they might have known what I was up to when I asked all these things about my father's activities. Yes.
Do you think that any of this stuff, like his report about the camp, will ever be released? And second question, if they are released, would you want to read it? And if you wouldn't want to read it, would that be denial?
Yes, I think it would be denial, just like Ike denied it and a lot of the brass denied it. For 2 weeks they didn't let it out, and even after they let it out, the concentration camps, the people at home didn't believe it. They thought it was propaganda. It took a long time for America to absorb what really had happened, even though there were rumors, they didn't know the extent of it. But I have a DVD with me, actually, of my father's testimony. He gave testimony to the Museum of Jewish Heritage about what he found at Ohrdruf. And we thought that maybe it was a little graphic to play, but you know, he said he gave his testimony when he was a very unemotional man in the sense of showing his emotions, but he had emotions when he told that, all those details. So the reports did come out, and unfortunately, the day that Ohrdruf was discovered was the day Roosevelt died.
Oh, yeah.
So it was, you know, the discovery of Ohrdruf, which was the first camp the Allies discovered, was sort of buried in the news, you know, there's no news hole for it. Yes?
You described that your relationship with your father changed when you were very young. I think you said you were 5. What do you attribute that to?
Well, it changed when I was about 13. And I mean, we were very close until then. And that was when I began asking him questions about his past. And there was a school project. We had to ask what our fathers had done in World War II. I asked him that, and he just, you know, would tell me funny stories about his time there, but he would never tell me anything serious. And the more I asked, the farther he moved away until he just absented himself from my life. And I didn't, you know, seek him out. I was too young to, you know, 14, to seek him out and say, why are you rejecting me? Because I thought it was my fault that I had done something. So this whole search and the answer to the mystery of my father sort of, you know, washed away some of the guilt I had, you know, for allegedly alienating my dad. Yes.
Would you attribute his failure in his personal life and business life to his experience in service?
Absolutely, without a doubt.
Yeah.
Before he went in, and one reason why he was older when he went in, he worked for a steel alloy company, General Alloys. They made metals for a special fighter plane. And his boss didn't want to let him go. He wanted to join the Navy and fight in the war. His boss didn't want him to. His boss would write the Navy Department saying, you have to give a pass to Thomas Franks. We need him for essential war materials. And my father would write his letter saying, I don't think they're so secret, and I want to go in the Navy. Finally, my father won. And his boss, you know, thought enough of him so that he hired him after the war. But by the time he came back from the war, he really wasn't the same person. Didn't have the same ambitions, couldn't carry out the same projects that he did before. And he worked for General Alloys, you know, until I was in my 30s, and then the whole company collapsed, and he was out of a job. Yes?
I am a Nazi German refugee.
You are?
And, yeah.
Wow.
And my parents and I came to America in 1941, just before I finished.
Mm.
And it took me a few years before I was able to even speak German. I love opera. I love the German in it. I couldn't stand it.
Mm-hmm.
And my son said to me, "Mom, why don't you write about your experiences?" And I said to him, "David, I'm not a writer." He said, "Try. You won't lose anything." So I said, no, goodbye. And he went off and I went off. But I went into the next little store and I bought myself a tablet.
Mm-hmm.
And I started writing. I couldn't stop.
Wow.
And now my sons have a book of that.
Ah.
Little book, very little. And I'm so glad I did it.
So did you get it published? Did you get
No.
You can, you know, the very inexpensively, you can get very nice bound books done by iUniverse, Libris Books.
No.
Just one handwritten tablet?
I had it typed.
Ah, okay. So copies could be made for your other...
Well, my family that have one.
Yes.
Took me a long time.
Oh, I imagine. Well, may I ask, were you a child that escaped?
19. I was 19, and my parents and I came here with $28.
How did you get out of Germany in 1941?
Quite legally, because at that time it was still possible. The first groups had been pushed into concentration camps.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted our apartment in Berlin, the Nazis, but permitted us to stay because we had an exit visa to America. So we stayed and left in a kind of a transport with $10 each. We got here was 28 because we bought a little chair for my dad on the boat.
Wow, that's amazing.
The Spanish boat, which was awful, it was
but it got you where you wanted to go.
got us here.
That's an amazing story. I'd love to read what you wrote. But
I'd like to add to that. Anybody who hasn't read this book should read it.
Oh, you've read the book?
Yes,
it's a very good book.
Where do you get it? You get it personally?
Yeah.
We're related.
Oh, okay. So maybe somebody could sort of purloin the book and get it to me.
Red, borrow, or steal.
In reference to what you mentioned, we just came back from a trip in Berlin.
Oh.
And someone took us around and showed us in front of houses and apartments a little plaque on the floor in the brick. And it had the name, for example, Gloria Rosenblatt, born such and such, Auschwitz, killed such and such. And the Berliners put that there in memory of the people that lived in that house.
Hmm.
And they did it on their own to recognize what occurred.
I don't know what the German for it is, but in English they called stumbling blocks. Stumbling blocks.
The blocks that were...
They're like half bricks in brass.
I see. And you could stumble
embedded in the sidewalk in front of the house.
It's called you trip over them.
Yeah.
Instead of him.
I don't know what the German is, but that was the English.
Do you think that any of you, all of you, that Germany has changed to the extent that this, you know, it's now several generations that they're still trying to make up for what their ancestors committed with all these museums and the plaques and the, I mean, do you think the core of that anti-Semitism?
They don't hide anything about the war in Berlin.
Mm-hmm.
In other areas of Germany, it's a little different. But in Berlin, they're out front about the horrors what occurred during the war. They don't try to hide anything.
No, the church that was at our corner has been left just the way.
Yes.
I was there, but it was bombed, actually. And it's been that way today.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, I covered the 1972 Olympics. I was just out of college, and I was on the night shift, and across the teletype came the news that Israeli compound has been occupied. And I had happened to be wearing an American tracksuit that from the American team that you could buy at the store. So I ran. I could run then. I ran into the compound and was, you know, quite a bit away, but I could see the shadows of the Uzi machine guns and of the terrorists. And the point of this story is that the next day I was assigned to interview all the Olympic guards. They were young people. And to a person, they said, I don't want to talk about that. It has nothing to do with Germany. I mean, this was on Israeli soil. And they were very, very defensive.
Yeah.
And, you know, just to see how that's changed since then is...
But there still is an underground of anti-men.
You think so?
Yes, there is in America.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
The crazos, the wackos that we see,
right,
who are well armed and
right,
and shaved heads and the whole thing.
Yes. Yeah.
And the neo-Nazis, I mean,
yes.
You don't know what you can see on the surface may not really
reveal
what's behind.
My son had a friend who wanted to go see his grandmother's tombstone. He went to, I think it was Frankfurt, and he went to the cemetery, and all the tombstones had been knocked down. It was just trashed. And apparently it had been that way since the war, and nobody had bothered to clean it up. And I wonder, you know, as I think back on it now, how can they build the museums and yet leave something like that, you know, as it was? So, you know, it's a yin and yang. You just don't really know.
Could they be leaving it to show what occurred as a memorial?
They had no plaque or no, this was, you know, what the Nazis did. It seemed to just be sort of forgotten.
It's so amazing that we people need hatred of something, somebody. Mm-hmm. And it's such an amazing need that humanity seems to have.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Very.
There's somebody back there. I'm sorry. Yes.
Excuse me, I have a call. In your research with your dad, did you come across any material where he worked with the Bonhoeffer family?
That's so interesting. No, I didn't. But Bonhoeffer was a real hero. I'm sorry.
Having the gentleman mention Bonhoeffer made me, in 1965, at a World Church Federation meeting, we were taken, escorted to Buchenwald.
Oh, God.
That is an experience that one never, never forgets. Mm-hmm. And it was taken for the purpose of having the clergy there,
mm-hmm,
carry the message,
mm-hmm,
of what something like that can do to, mm-hmm, humanity.
Right.
And it,
wow,
is something that steers you and you realize.
Really, did it affect you?
Well, I certainly remember it with grief,
right,
and yet I realized that it was an opportunity that was given to us, for a purpose,
and the purpose was to go back and tell
the clergy would
people what you really saw.
That's right.
That's you know, so much of these Spielberg organizations, Shoah, the Museum of Jewish Heritage, a lot of these organizations are taking testimony like mad from everybody, from somebody like you.
Yes.
They would love to have testimony. And, you know, because And they wanted particularly the Museum of Heritage to have my father, because he was a Christian. I mean, he became an atheist after the war, but he was, you know, Episcopalian altar boy. And they wanted Christians because, you know, they, to future generations, they would say it wouldn't happen. There would be some, you know, more, you know, a sense, an aura of truth, whatever, to somebody who didn't have a vested interest.
My husband was born in the Free City of Danzig, mm-hmm. which really they spoke German, wrote in German, but were not really Germans, they were a different country.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to go back and see it, and of course we went there. And then we went to, he wanted to go to Poland.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't, but he did. And we went to a museum that had relics of the people who had gone to concentration camps. I think the most touching happening for me was these little small gloves of little children
mm-hmm.
that were just exhibited there. Like mm-hmm. they had before they had been led to the fires.
And for Poland too. It's amazing. It's like the shoes at the National, at the Washington Holocaust Museum.
They are in Warsaw in the museum.
Yeah.
Well, I have some things to say with difficulty. In 1937, I sailed on the Bremen and landed in Bremerhaven in Germany.
Oh.
And I spent a month in Germany, and in 1934, I got wounded in Normandy.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
That's all.
Wow. Well, American hero.
What did you say? We can't hear what he's saying.
He was born in Normandy. Did I hear right? Yeah. Invasion. And went to Bremen in 1937. You mean 44, not 34, right? Yeah, 44. Right. Yeah. So he went, it was 37, he went to Bremerhaven, and then Holland, and then came back to fight in Normandy. And you landed on the beaches? No. Close to it.
Oh,
okay.
Wow.
Just close. But you still were invaded.
Yes.
That was, thank God you're here.
Oh, I do every night.
Repeat some of that.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Repeat some of that so we know what he said.
He said that he landed in close to Normandy. In 1944, and I said that that was an amazing thing to have done and survived, and thank God he's here.
Yeah.
And he said, I do every night.